My current research is looking at the diffusion of tactical innovations within social movements, and I'm particularly interested in the Women's Social and Political Union, which was established here in Manchester in 1903. And I'm interested in the new tactic that the WSPU brought to the campaign for votes for women in 1905, which was a tactic of militancy. So the idea was that you would intentionally try to get arrested and go to prison for the sake of the cause. So I'm interested in how this new tactic, how it spread to local areas, and why local women decided to adopt it or not for themselves. I've taken a social networks approach to looking at this question, and this involves mapping out the personal social networks of two suffragettes in particular. So I've taken one suffragette who did adopt militant tactics and one who didn't, and I've tried to explore the reasons why they made that decision. What I've argued is that it's less to do with their individual personality and their predispositions, and it's more to do with the nature of their personal social networks. So what I mean by that is it's more to do with the kind of discussion and debate that was happening with the people around them and the kind of expectations that arose from their interactions with the people around them. And so taking a social network approach helps us to look at the connections, the kind of web of connections within which these women were embedded, and to think about how the structure of those connections, but also the kind of meaning and culture that they gave rise to, affected their decisions on whether or not to adopt militancy. So that method involves mapping out personal social networks, and in order to do that, I use a computer software program called UCINet. And UCINet allows you to input data about people's connections with one another, and then to visualise the networks around these people. And it's really useful for measuring things to do with the properties of the structure of the network. So, for instance, I can look at who's the most central player within the network, and also what the composition of the network is. And this was really useful for seeing, for example, that it was WSPU travelling organisers that came to local areas that really gave these women opportunities to adopt militancy. And it also allowed me to see the frequency of their contact with other militants. What we're seeing in these two diagrams are the personal social networks of the two suffragettes that I've looked at. And I've looked at their personal social networks and mapped them using various different sources. So for one of the suffragettes, the historical archive that I've got mainly consists of diaries, family diaries that were written around the time. So I've reconstructed her personal connections over a number of years by looking at these diaries and the kind of relational information that we get from them. For the other suffragette, the main historical archives involve letters and also speeches that she made around the time of her imprisonments. So again, I've used these sources to find the data about their connections with other people within the suffragette movement. And I've used these to create these personal networks. And they're personal networks because they're the networks of connections around this one particular person. And these are what we call ego nets or actor-centred networks. This project's been part of a wider project that I've been involved in, and we've been looking at social networks that are involved in social movements more widely, and in particular we're interested in covert social movement networks. So the period when the suffragettes became involved in particular in covert activities, so when militancy became less about getting imprisoned for the cause and more about doing destructive acts like setting bombs and committing arson, where the whole intention was to escape. And we're interested really in how social networks that are involved in social movements, how they change and adapt when activity becomes underground and covert. So what we've done within this project is we've looked at several suffragettes and their personal networks. So one of the future steps is try and put those personal networks together and create more of a wider movement network and analyse that in both quantitative and qualitative ways. And it's very important within our project that we mix the methods within social network analysis. The main methodological contribution of this research was to use a mixed method approach to social network analysis. And in this respect, I think that formal social network analysis can benefit a lot from coming into contact with more qualitative approaches as well. But at the same time, qualitative approaches that concentrate maybe more upon the individual or the individual's relations with one or two significant others can also benefit from situating that individual within the wider social network. So I think it gets to a level of kind of intersubjective expectations and culture that perhaps a formal social network analysis on its own or a qualitative analysis on its own couldn't get to. So in that respect, we kind of see this as a model for doing a more mixed method social network analysis.